Good afternoon, students. Can you hear me?
Good afternoon, sir.
So today we are going to complete the neural network session. Today we are going to do it using a different set of tools. In the last 2 weeks, we had been using Python and coding the neural network from the scratch. But today, we are going to use a built-in library, a very famous library, to do the neural network training and testing. So this makes it much more easier and faster way to train neural networks for practical applications. Because when it comes to practical scenarios, it will usually have a large number of samples, and you may have to customize it using different mechanisms. Now, gradient descent and the delta rule are one of the easiest methods to learn and implement. However, they are not the most efficient ways to adjust the weight. There are more efficient methods like Liebenberg, which helps you adjust the weight faster. And also there are some additional things like adding momentum and so forth. So implementing everything from scratch will take considerable amount of time. Instead, we are going to use a library known as the TensorFlow. So today we are going to implement one of the practical cases using the TensorFlow library. Right. To get started with, let's log into the Google Colabs as we have been doing so far. Everybody, please log into the Google Colab and create a new notepad. So now I'm going to share my screen. So this is the one that we are going to use. So the library we are going to use is known as the TensorFlow. Right. In addition to that, there will be several new things happening in today's coding. Right. So you need to follow it step by step. And in certain steps, you will notice I am doing something new. Right. So then you have to. Then I will go to that extra length to explain why I am doing it and how it can be done, right? So that's the way we are going to use it. So the first difference is we are going to import the data from an external file. In the previous day, we had used only 8 samples. Therefore, we were able to type the sample data into the Python itself, into the Python notebook itself. However, in the real world, when you have a data set, it will be probably very large. So they might be stored either as a text file, a CSV file, or maybe Excel file. Maybe you have to get it from a database. So those things can happen, right? So the first difference is we are going to import a file that have this particular set of data. Now, where can we get this file? There are many open resources available for machine learning. Resources means there are many open databases that are available for us to use in freely. One of the most famous one is UCI Machine Learning Repository. If you go for this particular repository, this is maintained by a particular university. And you can see there are many data sets available. These are the most famous ones, but there are many more available for us to use. And you can filter them by different categories and so forth. For this time, for this particular example, we are going to use a library call, not a library, sorry, a data set about fuel usage of vehicles. So this is known as Auto MPG data set. So let me just type that one as well. So that way we can directly go to the link. Okay, here. So you need to follow with, you can follow with me in this one. Right. So this is what the data set summary looks like. Usually you get a summary table like this for every data set. It gives you different details. For example, this data is a multivariate data set. So you have different variables in here, not a single one. There are 398 instances. That means the number of samples. And there are 8 attributes. Attribute means properties. They have measured 8 things from this one. And attribute characteristics, they are categorical and real. So categorical means there are different types. For example, if you say a fruit, you can have apple, banana, pineapple, like that. They are different categories. Real means it's a number. If you measure a height of a person, it can be 100, 120, 200, 180, like that. It's a number. So you have these two broader definitions. Some data fall into different categories. So when you're, if you're trying to plot it, you have to plot them using bar graphs or something like that. You can't put them in a line because it's not, you can't have an order. You can't say apple comes before banana or something like that. Some are numerical values. So they basically gives you numbers. So you can put them in numbers. And when it comes to predicting, again, you have a slight different based on what you are trying to predict. The previous example was a categorical one. It was either yes or no. Either you belong to the set A or to the set B. That's why we used something like a hard limit in the final layer. So you get either 0 or 1. But let's say we are trying to predict something like a rainfall. Now a rainfall is a regressional data. That means you have a number. It can be 10 millimeters, 15 millimeters, 20 millimeters, like that. In that case, in the last layer, you have to use a sigmoid function or a ReLU function or a log sigmoid function, something that is continuous. So that is another thing you have to note down. Depending on the data type you are trying to predict, your transfer function in the last layer, you have to adjust, right? We'll come to that a little bit later. What else do we have? The data, the date it was set up and things like that. After that, it has the attribute information. So it mentioned there are 8 attributes. First variable is miles per gallon. So this is US, so that's why we have miles per gallon instead of liters, kilometers per liter, cylinders. Either 4 or 8 or 6 cylinders, displacement, horsepower, weight, acceleration, model year, origin, and the car name. So those are the things that will be available in our data set. So where is the data set? So if you go here, you have the data folder and the data set description. Data set description basically gives the same data, but in a separate text file. If you go to data folder, that is where you will find this data. Now this repository, this particular university repository, have different formats. Some data will be available in the Excel format, some will be plain CSV, some will be maybe in a different format. So like that, you have to be a little bit careful what type of format they are giving. So if you are interested, you can click it and the file will be downloaded and you can open it using a notepad. And here's what the file looks like. You can see there are 8 attributes. These are the data. So either you can save it into your Google Drive and import it from there. That is also possible. Or you can ask our TensorFlow library, which is the one that we are using today, to get the file directly from the given URL. So that's the method we are going to use. Okay, so let's get started. Do you have any questions about what we are doing? So the first thing is we are going to do is we are going to get the file. By the way, you have to import the relevant libraries first. Right, to get it working. Then we are going to first import our data into our Python notebook. So let's first import our TensorFlow. So I'm going to say import TensorFlow as TF. So whenever I am going to use a function inside the TensorFlow library, I can just say TF dot and give the function name. Inside the TensorFlow, there are a few other libraries as well. For example, the Keras library. So that is one of the libraries that help you implement the neural network easily. It has a much easier user interface, right? So we will import that as well. So it's inside this one. So I will say TensorFlow. And inside it, we will be basically importing, needing only the layer. So I'm just going to say layers. So this one basically imports the TensorFlow library. Okay, everyone came up to this point. Any questions? Methan tenakang oyagala karagattada loku deyak naha line deka kiyana vitharane thibbe karagattada. කොහමද කරගත්තද අමිල හරි නේද අමිල බුද්ධිකා
හරි
හරි මොන දැන් වෙනස තේරුණානේ right so you know the difference this time we are going to import the data from a URL not we are not going to type the data directly here so I am going to keep this cell for importing the libraries so I am going to create a new cell so it's easy to read okay let's add a text as to describe it as well. Let's import data. Right. So this is how we are going to import the data. First, we are going to use a function called getFile. Right. So that function will accept a URL and a file name, and it will get that particular file. So I will say data path yes dot utilities so that comes as utils dot get file right so we are going to use this library to get a file after that I have to give the file name and the URL So I'm going to copy paste it for you, so it will be easy. Otherwise, you can just copy paste it from here as well, right? So I can put it into the chat window as well. So the file name will be auto-mpg.data, right? So This is the file that we are going to import. And the URL is from here. So let's put that as well. Long URL, so it have a scroll bar as well. Again, I will put it into the chat window, so it will be easy for you to just copy paste it. So if everything is okay, you should be able to, first you have to run this one. Probably I will get an error because I'm trying to use this one before running the import statement. So let's interrupt this one and run this one first. You need to run, okay, what's happening here? Import TensorFlow.js import. Sorry, I made a syntax error. This should be from. Because I'm going into this library, this should be from. From this particular library, I'm going to import a function called layers. I'm not going to import everything. I'm only going to import this particular one. So that's why I said from. In here, I'm just basically importing everything so I can access it. Right. Again, there's an error. Did I make? Okay. I need to import this library as well. I forgot to import this one. So I'm using this particular library called Keras. So I should import that one as well. So I can say from TensorFlow import this one. Done. Now it should work. Okay, it's working. It's downloading the file. If you do this one, you should be able to get this particular one. Okay, it had been imported this particular place. So that is some additional data. We don't need it right at the moment, but I just wanted to check whether it was there. It had been now downloaded and already available. Right. Methan Tanakankara, is it okay up to this point? I'm going to add another command here. Lakshmi, what about you? You have finished up to this point?
No, sir. I'm still doing.
You're still doing, okay. Isha? So I made a small problem.
She's still doing.
Okay. Try to finish it. I made a small mistake at the beginning, so I corrected it later. So if you are not listening, anyone who is not paying attention, please note that for the second and third statement, I had to use the from statement, from keyword, not the import one, because I'm basically getting something inside this one, inside the TensorFlow. So I'm importing the Keras, which is inside the TensorFlow. That's why I say from TensorFlow import Keras.
Okay. Sir, I am getting an error saying name Keras not defined.
Okay, you have to include this particular syntax.
At that the also I did.
Then you have to run this cell as well.
Okay.
Nivanta, what about you? Finished? Still doing?
It's okay. I'm done.
Good. Buddhika?
When I executed the data path command, I didn't get the output as similar to yours.
Did it give you any errors?
No any errors.
Did it show you an download or something?
Initially it showed, sir, but then I did some change in the URL.
You run it again, then it's not there.
Yeah.
When that can happen. Okay. The reason is if the file is already there, it will not try to download it. For example, if I try to run it again, you won't get it. See?
Okay.
So it's a one-time scenario. After that, it will only use that particular, it will use in that particular downloaded file.
Okay.
Now, in our data set, we have all the data, but there's a small inconvenience. If you remember, the description of the data was in a separate file in the web page. And the numbers were on a separate file, which was the text file that I showed you. So if I want to say, get the displacement of a particular sample, I have to find which column it is representing. It is not very easy. Especially when you want to manipulate certain columns, you have to know which column represent which data or which attribute. A better way would be to define our column name. So we can later on just call it by the column name. Okay, give me the MPG, give me the number of cylinders, rather than calling it by the column number. Otherwise, I would have to say, give me the column one, column three, like that. So we will give them column names, right? So that's what we are going to do next. Okay. I'm going to create a list called column names. And inside it, I am going to give the names. Now, you already have the list of names. So I'm just going to put them into the list. And since this is not a typing exercise, I will put it in the chat for you to copy paste it as well. Okay, now when I run it, let's put it in this line as well. Okay, there, done, complete. Hiruni, finished?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Right. So we have created a list, which will be the column names. Now we are going to pre-process the data. So this list is still a separate list. It is not attached to our original data file. If you remember, it is not still attached to our original data file. And even in our data file, it is not exactly in separate columns. It was not an Excel file. It was just a text file. So if I show it to you for a second time, you will see it's not exactly separated. As humans, we can understand, okay, this space must mean there's a difference between this and this must be the end of this particular sample. But for a computer, it doesn't have that common sense. So we must tell it, okay, separate the columns using these spaces or tabs. And if there are any extra tabs, ignore them. At the end of the line, it will be a new sample. Like those kind of information we have to provide. If this was a CSV file, it would be much easier because every data is separated by a comma. But this one is a different one. You have a different format. So we need to process it. And also the column names are not there. So we have the list of the names, but they are not at the top. So we have to put them at the top as well. So when it comes to things like that, it will be easier for us to use a library, something that works with data. So we can very easily do this kind of pre-processing. So we are going to use another very famous library known as Pandas. It is basically a library that used for data analysis. So it has this functionality like assigning headers, selecting columns, separating the values. All these things are there. We only have to call the functions. So I'm going to import another library, import pandas as PD. Right. Now remember in the Python, if you execute only a single cell, only the statement inside that cell will be executed. If I want to execute everything, you can go to runtime, run all. So if I try to call a function from the pandas library, there will be an issue because I only typed it here, but I did not run this particular cell. So without running it, this statement, importing statement, will not be executed. That means this one will not be imported. So before calling for the functions inside the pandas library, I need to import it. To import it, I need to run the cell that has this importing function. So I'm going to run it. So now all these things were imported into this library. Now I can use the functions in the pandas library to get my pre-processing. So let's call it as pre-processing. Pre-processing means we are trying to process the data so it will be suitable for our neural network to work. Let's call it my data. Or we'll call it as original data. That will be better because later on we might have to modify it. So we call it as original data. And call the pandas library. Now I am going to use this particular function called read CSV. Now don't get confused. CSV stands for comma separated values. So ideally when you say CSV, it should be only be comma separated values. But in most of the cases, including Excel, it allows you to change the separating symbol. Instead of the comma, so you can define your own symbol, maybe a full stop, maybe a semicolon, maybe a space, something like that. So similarly, in the pandas read CSV library, read CSV function, we can include our own separation syntax. So in our case, I think it's a space that make the separation between the columns. So we can say, don't use commas, instead use space as the separating value. Right, so that's why I'm using the read CSV, although it is not technically a CSV file. Right. So the first thing it says is file path or the buffer. Right. So I have imported this file into a place in my file system, and it's stored at this place, data path. And if you remember, when I try to print the data path, it gives me an address. Right. So that's the place where we need to get the data from. Next one, separator. Okay. For the separator, I'm going to say separator space. So I'm going to include a space here. These are not two blank double quotations. In between them, you have a space. So it knows, okay, I'm going to use space as a separator. And what else we can do? Names. We can add column names. We can say names. For the names, we will give the column names, right? And what else? If you look at this text file, so you can download this text file to your own computer as well, because you know the website. You will notice there are some additional spaces as well. The columns are not separated by a single space. Sometimes you have more than one space between the columns, right? So we need to count for that as well. So I'm going to include two other syntaxes. Skip initial space. That will be true. And I'm going to say, if you have a tab character, consider them as comments. Because if you look at it, you will notice in the last line, you have a set of tab characters followed by the car name. So I'm going to consider them as the comments. And here's another important factor. In this data set, if you look at it, this particular one, missing values, it gives us yes. So that means for some samples, certain attributes are missing. They are not there. So how do you represent a missing value in the data set? For in this data set, you can see here's one place. So the person who created this data set decided to put a question mark when he doesn't know the value. So for this car, Ford Pinto or something, he doesn't know, I don't know, whatever this third column means. Something, I don't know what this column represent, 1, 2, 3, 4, horsepower. Yeah, this is the horsepower. So he doesn't know the horsepower. So he had put a question mark. On the previous day, I mentioned having missing values is very bad for a neural network. In fact, you can't work with a neural network that has missing values. So either there are different solutions for it. One solution is to ignore that sample. Another solution is to replace that with some other value, maybe a default value, maybe an average value, maybe maximum or minimum, depending on what you are trying to do. Now, in this case, we like to ignore those columns, ignore those samples, not columns, samples. So they are in the row order in the particular type. So that's what we are going to do next. So I'm going to say, if there are not available values, they will be represented with a question mark in the sample. So whenever it sees a question mark, it will be replaced by not available notation of the data set. Okay, because at the end of this we will get a data set. So if you don't have the data, it will be represented as, it will be whenever you have a question mark, that question mark will be converted to not available, right? Otherwise, if you have a question mark in a column, it will treat that question mark as a data itself, right? So for the car type, you might get a question mark. So that question mark doesn't mean you have a car type called question mark. It only means that data is not there. So that's why I have to include this particular one. So we have checked the part. We have the names. We have the separator. We have the skip layer. Okay, I think we are ready to go. So let's run it and see whether there are any errors. No errors, but it's better to see what our data look like, right? So what we can do is we can do a print. We can do a print like this. That's one possible way, right? So if you just do a print like this, it will give you we are getting a tab mark here. Okay, I have to check that one. If you do a print like this, it will give you a head and the tail. Head means the first few columns of the data set. Tail means the last few columns of the data set. If you only want the first part, you can just say head like this, then it will only give you the first part of the data. And if you want, you can pass parameters like how many rows do you want to display, right? So it seems like data is almost there, but for some reason I am getting this tab scenario. Why is that? Yes. I made a small mistake. Now, in the comment, it's tab means escape character, right? So that day you learn about escape characters. If I just put the T like this, that means it's a T, not a tab. If I have to have a tab, I have to put a backslash saying it's a tab character, how it should work. Okay, done. So what I'm basically doing is the car name was a comment in the original data set. They separated it using a tab character. All the other columns separated using space characters. Car name was separated using a tab character. So by giving this particular command, I am saying whatever after the tab is a comment. So ignore it. So basically I remove whatever the car name. So we are basically trying to predict the fuel economy. That means how far a car can go for a given amount of fuel. In this case, miles per gallon. So we are basically trying to predict a number, and for the time being, we have ignored this car name because car name is not going to give you any additional information. We are basically looking at this cylinder type, horsepower, and those things. So we have basically ignored it. Okay, everyone up to this point?
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, now when I run the code, the data I'm getting is not the same as what I can see in your screen.
Same means the numbers are different, or it is in a different format kind of?
Yeah, I think, shall I?
Can you share the screen? Are you using a computer?
Yeah, I'll share. So can you see?
You are not able to import it properly. Okay. Your URL might been a problem. That's the same one that I sent you through the chat window, right?
Initially, sir, I took it from the my PC itself, but then I noted something was different, and then I copied yours. Shall I do this again? And
yes, your URL is different because you are basically importing the web page, not the data. So you can see it's importing doctype HTML. I think what, okay, let me think what just happened. So when you are importing your data, you might have copy paste this particular address. So you might have copied this one.
Yeah.
That will be the web page. So you have to get the address from here. Or you, I will just put it in the chat window. If it is already there in the chat window, you can copy paste it.
I changed it after that noticing that I changed it.
But so it did not change.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Because I think change this data path name to something else, data path one or something, and change it here.
Oh. Okay.
Because it might not be updating your downloaded data because it's already there. Okay. Once it's downloaded, if the file is there, it will not try to replace it. It will not try to download it. It will use whatever already in the downloaded file.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Anyone else having any problems?
Sir, can you just clarify, please, this line under pre-processing?
This one?
That is original data equals to pd.create, that line.
Okay. So when we first import this data, it is just a text file. We want to change it into columns and rows. That means attributes and samples. In the original file, it's just a text file. So for as humans, we might be able to separate, okay, this is the first sample, second sample, like that. But for a computer, it's hard. So it's just like having a Word document and an Excel document. In the Excel document, you have a well-defined rows and columns. So I can say, go to this particular place. So that conversion is the thing that's happening here. We are trying to convert that text file into a data set. Data set means it's a one that has well-defined number of rows, columns, and maybe column names, things like that. Otherwise, it's just a text file. So that conversion is the one we are trying to do. So here we are basically separating the columns. So in our data set, the values are separated by spaces. So I'm saying, okay, whenever you have a space, consider it as a different column, right? So let's say something like this. Let me just copy paste the value. Okay, so this is one sample. So I must say, okay, this is the first value, this is the second attribute, third attribute, fourth attribute, fifth, sixth, like that. I must tell the computer, okay, 25.0 is the first one, this is the next one. Otherwise, it doesn't know. It might think, okay, this person has mistakenly put spaces, this must be 25.04, or this must be a single text value. So we have to tell it. So I'm basically saying, okay, spaces, you have a space here, so this is the end of this value. Here you have a value, again a space at the two different sides, so this is a different value, this is another different value. So use spaces to separate them. And skip initial space means, you can see there are many spaces between values. So I will say only consider a one space. Otherwise it will take, okay, this is another data set, this is another data set, this is another data set. That's not the case. You can have multiple spaces between data values. So I must say, okay, consider only one space, anything in between you can eject. That is what here, this one here. Comment means there's actually a tab between the car name and all the rest of this data. So I'm saying, okay, this is basically a comment, ignore it, because we can't process the textual data. right? Text you can't process in the neural network. So I'm going to convert them into comment and remove it. So that's what this one means. NA values means sometimes you don't have the data. Then the person has put a question mark. Now in the Excel, can you remember if you do something like 0 divided by 0, it will give a NaN. Or if you try to do something that is not there, it might give a reference error. In that case, that cell becomes like that hashtag NA, hashtag REF error, something like that. So when you get hashtag NA, that is not a number. That's the way Excel saying there's a problem with this cell, right? Similarly, we must say this data frame, when there are no data, we are going to use a question mark. So that's why we are putting it here. Then we have the column names. So rather than having it like this, we will add them just like in the Excel table. In the Excel table, you can have column names, headers. I am going to say for this data set, use this column names at the top. So that's what the data means. So this is what it looks like. You can see the column names at the top. And this last one is not available because it's a comment. It had been removed. All the other data is there. In addition, you can see the sample number. This is a new thing that comes with the data set. It says 5 rows and 8 columns are displayed in the initial display, right? Not a text, it says 5 rows and 8 columns. So now it's in the data set, or more or less like a table. Is it clear?
Yes, sir, thank you very much.
Right. Let's quickly go through the rest of the things. Right. So we are going to manipulate some of the data. So let's create a new variable for this one. This is not mandatory, but let's create a copy just for the sake. So I'm going to create a copy. Run it. Okay, it's there. I don't want to print it all the time, so I'm going to comment it out. So my new data is now called data. It's basically a copy. On the very first day, I told you why assignation mark doesn't work with list. It's better to use the copy function. And I have to do something about this not available data, because neural network can't work with it. So the easiest solution will be to remove any sample that doesn't have sufficient data. If there's a missing data, you will drop that sample. We can use it. We can do it now since this is a part of the data frame. There's a built-in function for this. Let's call it as, let's remove NA samples. So I'm going to say data assign data dot drop NA. So this one, what it does is it goes through the data, and if there are any samples with not available, that means data missing, it will drop the sample, right? So that's what this particular statement does. So now we have a set of data. Let's print it and see, just for the fun. Okay, data is there. Everything seems fine. Right. Part of the pre-processing is complete, but not finished. We have some more work to do. If you look at this data, you will notice there's a considerable amount of variation among them. For example, this displacement value seems to be going from something like 100 to 300. Seems like that, roughly in that range. Cylinders, on the other hand, have only two or three values, 4, 6, and probably 8. My MPG again goes in the range 18 to 31, while this model year seems to be something like 70 to 80. So you can see the range is different, starting value is different, the deviation is different. So when you have so much differences, it will become a little hard for neural network to train, because one variable only changes between 10 and 20. Another change from 1,000 to 2,000. Another is only changing from 1 to 10. So it will become problematic. It's better to help the neural network by normalizing the data. So we are going to normalize the data. So how do you normalize the data? Can anyone tell me the statistical formula for normalizing? You know that A level, when you calculate Z score, how do you calculate it? Can you remember formula like X minus mu divided by sigma? Right? මතකද එහෙම ෆෝමියුලා එකක් ඔය නෝමලයිස් කරන්නේ කොහොමද ඩේටා සෙට් එක කොහොමද කරන්නේ කියලා ඕකේ so I will show you the equation otherwise you might not remember it because you have it's hard to type the sigma marks here this one x minus mu divided by sigma I hope you remember it. So that's the way we are going to normalize the data, right? So how can we get the mu and everything? Lucky, because our Panda data frame allows us to do all these things. For example, if I say print data dot mu, sorry, I put it in the textual, and this should be in the code here. This should say we are normalizing the data. This is just a comment. When you say this is only happening because this is a data frame, okay? Data dot mean. So if it is a data frame, you can have functions like this one, drop NA. Another one is the mean. So if you say mean, you can see the average values. MPG average is this, cylinders, this is the average, this is the average. For each column, you get an average. Similarly, if I do something like STD, standard deviation, you get a standard deviation. So we can use this data to calculate a normalized data set. That's what we are going to do. We are going to say normalized data, say norm data is equal to X minus mu. X is the original value. So in our case, data minus mu. Mu means the average, the mean. So we are going to say data dot mean. Divided by sigma, that means data dot std and parenthesis. Now remember, putting this parenthesis means you are calling a function. So I'm calling a function to calculate the mean and the standard deviation. So now it should work. Okay. It's working fine. We'll print it and see. Then you will notice there's a small problem with this one. Okay. Using this formula, I am able to normalize the data. You can see instead of having 18, 80, 300 something, you have that usual range, right? If you look at the Z score, you usually get something like between minus 2 and plus 2, something like that. So we see the same trend in here, right? Sort of like a normalized. Any question up to this point? Did you get the idea why we are normalizing and how we are normalizing? So why do we need to normalize the data? Let's ask a voluntary person. Let's ask Hiruni. So why do we need to normalize the data?
Some statistical test before you may, when we going to use the statistical test, we have to clear that our data set is normal.
Okay, we'll ask someone again. Who else can we ask? Buddhika? Why do you think we need to normalize the data?
Because it's in different scales. It's measured in different units.
Yes, because they have so many diversity. It's in different scale, different variations, different starting points. So it will be hard for neural network to adjust to it, right? So that's why we need to normalize it, right? So that's so I hope you know the formula for normalizing. So we normalize it. But there's one column that has a problematic scenario. Can you guess which column it is? A column that we should not have normalized. Can anyone guess? At the very beginning, I mentioned
the model here.
Not exactly. That's somewhat.
Name of the car.
That's no longer in the data set. We removed it as a comment. So think about the different data types you have here. At the very first dimension, there are two data types. Basically, there are two categories representing data. One is called regression, other one is called categorical. Can you remember? Now, can you guess which column that we should not have normalized?
Number of cylinders?
No.
Origin?
Yes, the origin. The reason is all other values like this, MPG, cylinders, and everything are numerical values. They are basically numbers. So numbers you can normalize. Origin is not a number. Origin is actually, if you read it, it says the US is zero, Japan is one, and something like that. I can't remember, but it will be in the data set. So it's not a number actually. Only reason that it put as a number here is they have represented using a number, but it's not a value. Japan is not twice as like as because it has number two. It's not like that, right? So think about it like, let's say your school or your, let's say this class. So I'm going to normalize some data set. So this data set has, let's say, your name, marks for this course, marks for another course, and maybe let's say your gender, right? So now I try to normalize it. Marks you can normalize, but let's say if you try to normalize girls and boys between 0 and 1, you will be end up with a very bad situation. Something like 0.5 will be a quite a troublesome scenario. So categorical data you should not normalize. That will provide with you a higher problem, right? So this origin is a categorical data. It should not be normalized. So we have to remove it. So rather than removing it from normalizing, easier way to replace it with the original data set, right? So what I'm basically going to do is after normalizing, after this has been replaced, I am going to replace it back. So I'm going to say norm data, and I'm going to give you a column name. Usually you can give the column number, but since this is the data set and we have already given the column names, I can call it by the column name. I can say origin. So this is the same syntax as when you want to replace a value in the list. Norm data origin, it should be replaced by the original one. Data origin. What I'm basically is, I have the data origin here, which is not normalized. And this is the normalized data set. I am going to replace this particular column, this origin column, with this column. So everything else is normalized, but this origin column will be now replaced by the not normalized column. Okay, you can see it's now there. Right. Did you get the idea why we had to do this particular scene line? Let's put a comment and say, you can't actually normalize a country code, something like that. It doesn't make any sense. You can't take averages, standard deviation between categorical data. It doesn't make any sense. If you say, ask, what is the average between apple and a banana? You can't say. What is the average between the tallest student and the shortest student? You can do, because it's the same parameter, different numbers. Apple and banana don't have numbers, right? I hope you got the idea. Is it okay? Because next I'm going to give you another new situation. Is it okay with everyone? ප්‍රශ්න තියෙනවද ගැටලු තියෙනවද නම් අහන්න නිවන්ත හරිද
all good sir thank you
රතිනි
yes sir
okay right now I mentioned when I go through this code I will have to divert to certain scenarios to explain certain things right so these things are not always relevant to always not limited to this example. There are some common things, right? For example, importing the data from external URL, common thing. Having to convert them to a suitable format like CSV or something, again, very common. Having to normalize, again, something that is very common. And not normalizing the categorical data, that is something you should never do, right? Right. Now I'm going to give you another concept when it comes to neural networks. On the first 2 days, we had a categorical kind of examples where we try to guess whether we get a profit or not. So it was a yes or no. We encoded yes as I think zero, no as one, or something like that, zero and one. So based on the value you got, you could categorize them back into yes or no. Let's say your neural network gave 0.99. Most likely it is trying to say it's a yes. If you get something like 0.00 or 1, that will be a no. Something like 0.4 or 0.6 means somewhere in the middle. So its neural network is not sure, but based on the value, either you can round it up or round it down. So for two classes, when you have only two categories, it's easy. You can put zero for one category, one to encode the second category. But what will happen if you have three different categories? Let's say you have you are trying to predict the favorite color of someone based on some data, maybe the things they use or things like that. So there are three colors. red, green, and blue. Now, obviously, neural network can't work with textual data. So you have to encode it. Just like yes and no encoded 0 and 1. Now you have to encode three different category names, red, green, and blue, into numbers. How do you convert it? Any suggestions? So now you have three.
You can assign numbers for.
Yes, what numbers? So what are you going to assign for them? Red is represented by what? Green is represented by what? And blue by what number? Now in the previous case, we had yes and no. I think yes was represented by 1 and no was represented by 0. Something like this. So when you get a result, you have 1 here, you have 0 here, and somewhere in the middle you have 0.5. So if your neural network predicted value like this, you will assume okay, it's a yes. If it predicted a value like this, you will assume a value like no. If it is something like this, that probably means it's not better to go into judgment. It's not sure whether it's this side or this side. But something like this means definite yes. So that was the whole idea in the previous day. So now we have three. What should be the numbers there? Earlier it was 1 and 0. Now,
binary numbers. I mean. 100.
Okay, can you give me some results? What do you want to put for the R?
0014R.
0014R. For the green?
010.
010. For the blue?
100.
100. Okay. That is the answer from. This is the first answer. Amira, you answer it, right?
Yes.
We'll put A. Amira's answer. Any other people? Let's ask the second person in the list, Buddhika. In the participation list, you are the second person. What is your opinion? How should we categorize them?
10 for R. For G, 01. 00 for B.
Okay, so A, B. One person have a chance. Who would like to be the volunteer? We'll ask from the end of the list now. Sachini, what do you think? So these people are going with binary. What do you think? Do you agree? Or do you have your own opinion? What do you think?
So I think we can go with binary, right?
You think you can go with the binary, okay. Do you have your own system or do you think this is fine, one of those two systems?
In Buddhika's answer, R can change with 1 and 1, others are same.
Now you are saying it could be 1, 1, others are same, like this.
Sir, you can assign a 1, 10 and 100, right? Because
one.
Then you can... In
100.
Then if you take the combination of color, you can figure out from which how much amount came from which portion, something like that.
Okay. That's Nivant, right?
Yes.
I am putting the names because I don't want to ask the same person twice. Last one. Let's ask
Sir, like sharp FF 40, sir. I think it's a mix of the red, green, and blue. What percentage of red is we are taking? Like that, it is coding.
I didn't quite follow you. Now, we are not going into image processing or anything. I'm just saying we are trying to guess the favorite color of a person. Yeah. It can be either red, green, or blue. Let's say it has, he's going to pick a hat or a cap or something. So there are three variations, right? Green and blue. We want our neural network to know which color he's going to pick. So we want to encode it. So what do you think is...
Is it going with the binary coding?
It can be binary, decimal, hexadecimal, or Babylonian number system, whatever you like. This is an open kind of discussion. You can come up with anything. Even Sinhala letters, I don't mind.
If hexadecimals, it's double F and... 0 0 4 0s. I don't know how to
Okay, no one thinking about putting 1 and 2 and 3.
So can't we take a range or something?
Range,
like sir, when we are assigning for the marks, we are assigning ABC. Like that way, can't we take a range?
Okay, give me a range.
Like, like 0 to 0.3 R, 0.3 to 0.6 or 0.7, 0.3 to 0.6 green, then...
0.6 to 0.9 is?
Yeah, 0.7 can be, I think. 0.3 to 0.9. Middle one, okay. Green one, yeah.
Okay, 0. We can put greater than or equal than sign. Okay, right. So this, come up with some new variations with it. Okay, I never thought it will be all like that. Usually people come with this one, easiest one, 1, 2, 3. If 0 and 1 goes for yes and no, 0, 1 and 2 will go for yes, no, and something else, maybe. So what I wanted to mention is, depending on the encoding, your performance can change, right? So when you have more than two categories, this one is the suitable one, the most suitable one mentioned by the Amila. This is known as the one-hot encoding. It has its name called one-hot encoding because at any given category, only one value will become true. So in this case, only the last value become true, middle value and the first value. But in other combinations, you have different variations. You have more than two value become true. Maybe sometimes you don't have any value becoming true. And here you have a complete range. And this one again have a range. So they all have their own problem. So let me quickly explain it using an example. So the most famous example I'm always using for this one is the cricket example. So some of you might have already gone through my other videos and might have noticed it. Right. Give me the best cricket team. What's the best team at the modern day, at the present time? How many of you are watching cricket? Is there any favorite sport that you like other than cricket? I don't know. How many of you are watching cricket? හරි අමාරු ප්‍රශ්න න්‍යූරෝ නෙට්වර්ක් වලට අහු ඉඳලා ඉඳලා කවුද ක්‍රිකට් බලන්නේ කියලා. ලක්මල් do you watch cricket?
Yes.
Okay, good. What is the best team in these days? I don't know. I haven't been spending much time on cricket.
These days maybe England or South Africa or India.
Okay, what is your first choice? First choice. You can't give four or more. You have to tell one only. First choice?
Okay. India.
You think India is the best one? Okay, good. we'll put India. Who else watch cricket? I don't know whether girls are watching cricket. So let's ask a boy. Lahiru, what is your favorite team? What do you think? Do you think is the best team? Not the favorite, best one. You don't watch cricket. Okay, I get it. You are not watching cricket. Okay.
No, actually, I don't like cricket. No.
Okay, you are like me there. So, Lakmal, you were the one that had about four lists. So, you can give the second place as well. Who's the second best in your opinion? You said India is the first. Second place?
South Africa.
South Africa. Okay, we put South Africa there. Okay, the worst team? What do you think is the worst team? The team that's never going to win? Is there a team like that? I don't know.
Maybe Sri Lanka?
Okay. Sri Lanka is the worst team. Okay. Your opinion. I don't know. Right. So I'm going to create a neural network to predict which country is going to win. But I'm going to use it. I'm going to build it based on you. That means students. You are the neuron. Okay. So I need to encode these three countries into categories. So for the first time, I will go into encode it using, let's say, India and Sri Lanka only, two categories. So India is 0. Sri Lanka is 1. Now, I'm not good at cricket. So I'm going to ask you people to vote so I know which country is going to win, right? So let's say we have 12 students there. 10 students vote for India, right? So now I'm going to count the votes and get the average. So what's going to happen is I'm going to get 10 people vote for India and 2 people vote for Sri Lanka. So average, I'm going to get, so this will be 12. Sorry. 2 divided by 12, some bad number, something very close to 0. 0.01 or something, right? So what does this mean? 0.0 means it's very close to 0. So probably India is going to win. Now let's assume for some reason our cricket team became very good. So everyone thinks Sri Lanka is going to win. So everyone is going to vote for Sri Lanka. So everyone is going to, I forgot to mention you the method that you are going to vote. The method you are going to vote is you are going to write down either a 0 or 1 and give that card for me, give that number to me. So I'm going to add all these numbers and take the average, right? So in the first case, I got 10 zeros, 10 cards with zeros, 2 cards with 1. So average turns out to be 0.1 something. Now assume everyone thinks Sri Lanka is going to win. So what will be the average value I will get? All 12 people are going to vote for Sri Lanka. So they are going to write down which number in their card, in their voting card, what number are you going to write?
1.
So when I average all the 12, what will I get?
1 again.
Let's say 90% of your class is going for Sri Lanka, 10% for the India. What will be a likely value I would get? Some closed value? Not the exact calculated number, but some rough range.
0.9 or something.
Yeah, 0.9 or something. Let's say half of the people for Sri Lanka, half for the India. Now what's going to happen? 0.5, yes. So depending on the value, that single value I am going to get, I am going to determine whether it's India or Sri Lanka that is going to win, right? So this is similar to what we happening in our previous neural network. We had 0.5 in the middle. If it's less than this one, you are going to vote it for the India. If it's more than 0.5, you are going to vote it for Sri Lanka, right? Now things are going to change. So this is a cricket tournament where three countries are participating. We put South Africa into the group. Okay, now it's getting interesting. CO for India, one for Sri Lanka. For South Africa, I am going to encode it as 2. Nice. So let's assume everyone is voting for South Africa. What will be the average value I will be getting? If everyone vote for South Africa,
two,
right? It's the same scenario. So I gave you each one of you a separate card. You write down the code of the country you want to vote. So all of you, or majority of you, will think South Africa wins. So you put 2. So when I collected the cards and average them together, you will get a 2. Okay, right. So that way you can get some idea. So everyone thinks India is going to win, or majority thinks India is going to win. What will be the value I will get? If I get a value like close to 2, I will think South Africa is going to win. If everyone votes for India, what's the value I'm going to get as the output from my neural network?
Translate
the neural network, right? 0. So how should I interpret this 0? Which country is going to win? So when I average it, I get a 0. Now I need to convert it back to one of these three countries. So based on this, what should be my best choice? Which country should I bet for as winning?
For India.
For India, right. So you got the scenario, right? I give you each a card. You write the code of the country you are thinking is going to win. Then I am going to average it and get a single number. So based on that number, I am going to interpret which country is going to win. Now, here's the funny thing. Let's assume 5 of you are going to vote for the think South Africa is going to win. 5 of you are going to think South Africa is going to win. 5 of you are going to think India is going to win. No one is thinking Sri Lanka is going to win. What will be the average I get after doing the calculation?
1,
right? I am going to get 1. So when I get a 1, what do you think I am going to interpret this as? Which country is going to win?
Sri Lanka.
Sri Lanka. Because I, whenever I get something close to 0, I am going to interpret as India is going to win. Whenever I am getting a value close to 2, I am going to interpret as it's going to be South Africa that's going to win. If everyone is voted for Sri Lanka, then I am going to get a 1. So I can interpret as it's a Sri Lanka that is going to win. But this is not the only time I can get a 1. Even if no one voted for Sri Lanka, they voted for India and South Africa, at the end, I might end up with a 1. So I can misrepresent my result. So I can mistakenly think everyone thinks Sri Lanka is going to win. But in reality, nobody had thought Sri Lanka is going to win. So now I think you got the idea why the encoding is should be carefully done. If you put just numbers for each class, you can end up with something like this. Right? Let's say you are going to classify something like vegetables and animals. You put 0 for a carrot. You put 2 for a beetroot. and you put one for a giraffe. Now there can be a case where the vegetable in the picture is black and white and you can't sort of like figure out whether it's a carrot or a beetroot, but you might end up thinking it's a giraffe, right? So it's obviously not going to work. So that's where this one-hot encoding comes in. So in the one-hot encoding, what we are basically going to do is we are going to encode it like this. We have three classes, A, B, C. For each scenario, you have only one possible combination. You might have something like 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, and 1, 0, 0. And at the end, I am going to average all the three columns. So let's say everyone thinks A is going to win. I am going to get an average of 0, 0, 1. Fine. That will be okay. If half of the people think A is going to win, half of the people think C is going to win, I will end up with a value like 0.5. That means half of the people think A is going to win. 0.5 for the last one. This 0.5 comes from here. This one comes from here. And a zero in the middle. So now this correctly represented our scenario. This is 0.5, that means half of the people think it's there. This is 0.5, another half thinks here, but this is zero, nobody thinks it's going to be. If it was something like 0.6 and 0.4, we can think most likely this class is the one, but if you ask for a second opinion, this might be the second guess. But this will never be the correct class, right? Something like that. So that's what called the one-hot encoding. I hope you got the idea. Eka pahadili the Buddhika, is it okay with you?
Yes, sir.
Lakshmi?
Yes, sir.
Nivanta?
How do we differentiate it with the scenario where everyone votes one? You simply count the number, right? In that case, because if it is average is one, you divide it like 0.5 and 0.5 and try to predict the result. But if it is actually one, the difference between everybody voting for one and getting an average as one, and this scenario where half votes for zero and half votes for two.
Yes. So for example, in the first case, you can't do it. That's why I mentioned putting 1, 2, 3 is not going to work. But in the second case, you can imagine like this. Now, when I gave you a card, you have three columns. A, let's say rows, B, and C. If you think country A is going to win, you can put a 1 here. Country B, you can put a 1 here. C, you can put a 1 here. But you can only mark one country as your winning one. So this is your new voting card. So if you think country A is going to win, you can put a 1 here. B is not going to win. C is not going to win. Got the idea? So assume you have 100 cards like this. Let's say 12 cards for the 12 students in here. So I might end up with a table like this. Some people are voting for the A. So I might end up with 1, 1, 1. These students voted for 1. First student, second student, third student. Fourth student voted for the B. Fifth student voted for, let's say C. And another student voted for C. And another student voted for C. Right? So these are the votings of the different students. So these are A, B, C. This is the first student, second one's result, third one's result, like that. Then I add them up. So I end up with 1, 2, 3. For the B, I have only 1. For the C, I have again 3. Now I am going to take the average. I have 3, 6, 7. Okay, very bad number. Let's say this is 6. Okay. So this will be roughly about 0.4 or something. This would be something like again 0.45 or something. This would be something like 0.1, okay? Something you have to assume. This should add up to one, but assume like this. So now when you look at it, you can see the differences. 0.454 for the A, 0.1 for the B, 0.45 for the, again for the C. So now in the end result, I am having three numbers, not one. Three numbers. So based on these three, I can guess which one is going to win. First one represents likelihood of A winning. Second one represents likelihood of B being the winner. Third one represents the likelihood of C being the winner. So by looking at this one and getting the biggest one, in this case it's equal. Let's put another one here. And let's convert it to 0.5. So 0.5 is the biggest one. So by looking at this, I can estimate, okay, C must be the one that is going to win. There's no chance I'm going to average these three together and come up with a misrepresentation like this. Because in this representation, each class need to have a separate place to hold its value. So this is the likelihood of A being win, C, B, and C. Is it okay? So the another thing you have to take about this neural network is, in the earlier case, we had only one neural network outputting a single number. So this could be at a zero or a one. But if you are going with this scenario, that means when you have more than two categories, you need to have multiple outputs. In this case, we need to have one output for the A, one output for the B, and another output for the C. So you have the rest of the neural network here connected together in different ways. But in the last layer, you have three outputs. So if the neural network's three outputs get something like 0.9, 0.1, and 0.0, I can safely assume the correct class is class A. Right? If I had 0.9 here and 0 here, most likely correct class is class B. If I have something like 0.6, 0.1, and 0.3, I can say, okay, this is most likely this is class A, but not confident, not that sure, because it's only a 0.6. There's a half, almost half a chance it may not be a class A. But from the given choices, this should be the most likely one. B is the least likely one. It's almost sure that it's not going to be the correct class. C is again somewhere there on the top of the fence, but not good as the choice number A. So if I were to classify, categorize, or interpret the data, I will say in neural network is saying this is most likely class A, right? So similarly, in that scenario, you need to have one output for each class. Is it okay, Terunada? Sachin, is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. Then we shall continue with this rest of the coding. One student has gone missing. I don't know what happened.
So Hiruni told that there's a power cut in the area.
Oh, okay. Right. Let's go back to the original code. Now, why did I have to divert from there? The reason is this origin is actually categorical data, and it is not only two categories. Although in this sample, you can only see in one and two, there are actually three categories. You have the USA, you have the Europe, and you have the Japan. That means you have to do the encoding as I mentioned. You can't simply use one, two, and three for your categories, right? In the original data, that is how it is encoded. One for US, two for Europe, and three for Japan. But you can't use that directly for the neural network. If you try to do that, you might get confused. A vehicle might be somewhere between USA version and a Japan version. It might misrepresent it as a Europe version because one and three in the middle, you get the two. And two itself has a class, right? So we have to do the one-hot encoding to prevent that. So we will say, use one-hot encoding for the origin. So that is why I had to go that extra depth to explain why it is important. Now in Pandas case, you can have, you have a built-in way to do it, but I will use the manual way to do it. The manual way would be to, first I need to replace this particular origin column with my new three columns. So I'm going to remove this particular column. I don't need this one. I'm going to replace it with three separate columns, one for US, one for Europe, one for Japan. Right? Did you get what I'm trying to say? So instead of 1, 2, 3, now in the original data set, I have one is for US. So let me put it like this. You have three numbers in the original data set, 1, 2, and 3. This is for the origin. But I can't use numbers like this, 1 and 2 and 3, when you have more than two categories. So I have to encode it separately. So what do I have? I have one actually represent the USA. Any car manufactured by USA is represented by one in this particular column. This is Europe. And this is Japan. So for the US, I'm going to represent it using three categories, 100. Europe, 010. For Japan, I'm going to represent as 001. So instead of this particular origin column where we had three numbers, I am going to have something like this. So this can be further simplified. Rather than having this encoding, I can simply say 100. It's a Euro, sorry, USA, Euro, Japan. So if I get something like 100, that means this is most likely a USA one. If it's a Europe one, I will get 010. For a Japan one, I will get 001. Okay, so that is the conversion I'm going to do. I will get three new columns. So this particular pattern, this pattern represent a car made in the USA. In other words, the original number should be one. If it's original number one, in the origin column, it will be replaced by 100. If the original number is two, that means car made from US, Europe, it will be replaced by 010. If the original number is three, it will be replaced by 001. So that's the idea. I am going to replace this origin column with three different columns, Europe, England, and Europe and Japan. And when if it is one, it will be 100. If the origin is two, 010. If it is three, it will be 001. So this is the one hot encoding for the origin country. Okay, so let me show how it is done. So I'm going to remove this origin column, so I can do it using, not remove, actually remove and assign into a different variable. Origin is equal to norm data. We have a function called pop. Then you can give the name origin. So the data in this origin column will be replaced will be removed from the data set and be assigned to this variable origin. That's what the pop norm data. What it does. Now I'm going to look at the value of this origin column, or in other words, in this variable, and replace it with that one hot encoding pattern. So I'm going to say norm data. I'm going to create a new column. If this particular column is not there, it will automatically be created. Say if origin is equal to one. If origin is equal to one, I am going to assign a one. Now I want to make sure it's a number, so I'm going to say multiply by 10. And similarly, I'm going to create the Europe. If the origin value is equal to 2. What's happening? Okay, for some reason it didn't work. I must have forgot to run this previous scenario. Anyway, now it's working. So this is the format I want. You can see it's one hot encoding, right? Only one value will be true from all these three columns. So here you get one. So this is a Europe car, and most of them are from the USA, right? Now the one hot encoding part is done. Were you able to do it? If you get an error, try running it everything again from the run all, because it seems like if you didn't use the this notebook for some certain time, you might get disconnected, and then certain data may not be readily available. You might have to rerun the whole notebook. Okay, any questions up to this point? මෙච්චරලා කළපු දේවල් වලින් අහන්න යමක් තිබේද ප්‍රශ්න කැටලු තිබේද Hemant, are you okay up to this point? Is it okay, everything?
For this Japan, we are getting all zeros, right?
Yes, because only this is only part of a sample. You can see only the first five and the last five.
Okay,
so
okay.
Japan is somewhere in the middle. You might have one or two cars with Japan, but seems like in the ones that are shown here, there's nothing showing for the Japan. One thing you can do is you can print rest of the data. In that case, what you can do is you can say.
It's okay, sir.
Okay. Any other questions? There's something called display max rows. Okay, see if you can. Okay, that's one. There are a few more like this. So, this is the full data set. So, now you can see there are certain cases where you have Japan. So, I'm going to remove it back to 10. Otherwise, every time I try a print, I will fill the whole screen with it. Isha, what about you? Finish typing? Still working? Sachin, what about you? Finished?
Yes, sir. Finish. Can you please show again how to print the whole data set?
You mean the way that you print everything?
Yes, sir.
There's an option called. So if you go to PD, now Pandas is the one that we are going to write, right? PD dot set option. There you have to say display. Max rows, max number of rows. After that, you can give any number. So if you want everything without any limit, you can say none. If you put 10 or 5 or whatever you like, then that will be the number of rows that will be displayed on the screen. By default, you get only the first 5 and the last 5 as the sample.
Okay, sir, thank you.
Right, now we are almost there. We need to do another small thing for our data set. If you remember, we need to separate our training and testing data set. Why do we need to separate training and testing data set? Can anyone answer? Buddhika, what do you think? Why do we need to separate training and testing data set? What is the advantage?
Because when you have to test using a different data set, otherwise, if we are going to use the same data set to test also, we will have like the accuracy might be a little misleading.
Yes, you have got it correctly. So it's just like the students who are learning in the class. If I explain some examples, let's say I'm teaching maths and I'm giving you some examples to learn, right? And if I give the same example for the exam, what will happen? Now the people who have just memorized the examples might get full marks without understanding the concept. So I have to give something different. So that's the same with the neural network. We are trying to teach the neural network through examples. So if we want to know if it had learned properly, we have to give it a different set, a different question to classify, right? So your answer is correct. That's why we need to separate training and testing data set. So that's what we are going to do next. So far we have pre-processed everything. This should be the text code. Okay, let's put a comment and say separating testing and test and train data sets. Okay. Again, there are different ways you can separate. You can separate manually by picking up a set of rows, right? You know how to do it using slice. You put a colon and select it. Or we can use, since we already have a data frame, it's better to use that one because it have a built-in way to separate it, right? So we are going to start by training data. Training data. We are going to get our data set, norm data. Then we have a function called sample. So this is again a function from the Pandas library. So this allows us to, you can see the pop-up, right? I believe you can see the pop-up when I'm sharing. Return a random sample of items from an axis. Axis means either x or y axis, right? That means column wise or row wise. So this allows us to randomly select a set of samples. If you want, you can do it manually. When we are discussing about the random keyword, I told you how to pick random numbers and so forth. So the first parameter we need to have is the fraction. How much percentage we need. So I'm going to give 80%. So for the training, I am going to give 80% of the original data set. We have the normal data, which is the original data set, normalized data set. From it, 80% goes for the training. So I say fraction assign 0.8. And if you want, you can random them as well, depending on how do you want to randomize them. So I'm going to say random state 0. So with this one, we are able to create a set of training data. Okay. Now we need to create the testing data set as well. So how can we create the testing data set? There are different ways you can do it again. One of the easiest ways to, we take the original data set, which is the normal data, and remove the data that had been selected for the training data. Right? So what happens so far is we take our data set, from it 80% is marked to be put into the training data. So they are marked and they have been moved into the training data set. For the testing, what I can do is I can again take that large data set and remove the samples that have been already marked for the training data. We are going to remove the training data set from the original large sample. So what is remaining will be the 20% that we can use for the testing. So that way we are mutually exclusive. We can say testing data. Normal data. Here I can say drop. Drop means remove. So I take the normal data set and from it drop certain amount of samples. And remaining ones will be assigned to the testing data set. Right? So how can I select the training data set? Well, we already have the training data. But if you are dropping, what you have to give is the index. That means a place. First sample, second sample, third sample, like that. So I am going to say from our original normal data set, drop training data index. Okay, you got the idea? So what this one does is it will go to the training data and get all the indexes, 0, 5, 6, 10, something like that, the places. So now I know the places where samples have been taken for the training. So I'm dropping them. So from my large sample, I'm dropping that first place one, third place one, fifth place one, like that. So the remaining ones, I'm going to assign in for the testing. I am going to assign for the testing. Done. Okay, came up to this point. Then we have to do another separation. We have to separate the inputs and the outputs. What we are feeding into the neural network and what we expect from our neural network. So our lecture, we started with saying we are going to predict the fuel economy of a vehicle. That means how far a car can go for a given amount of fuel. So if you look at these attributes, which one should be the input, which one should be the output of our neural network? What do you think? Sachin, what do you think? Which one should be the inputs? Which one should be the outputs? Now you have different columns, different attributes. What do you think?
Sir, can I please ask the question again? I didn't get it correctly.
Okay, now in the neural network, you have inputs and outputs. In the previous day, we input the price and output was a prediction whether we are going to make a profit or not, right? So we input the price and output was the profit. Similarly, in this case, which will be the input for our neural network and which values will be, values means attributes. So columns will be suitable for the output. Now we have MPG, cylinders, displacement, and so on. Which one do you think should be the output? The one we are going to predict. Just think. Yeah. Anyone else?
So MPG should be our output, right? Because we are MPG, machine.
Yeah, exactly. MPG should be our output. Maybe that Sachin got confused with the word MPG. MPG stands for miles per gallon, right? So we are trying to predict how many miles will a vehicle go for a given amount of fuel. So that's what we are trying to predict, as I mentioned in the beginning. So that will be our output. That's the one we are going to predict. Now, of course, depending on the scenario, other things can also change. For example, someone might try to predict the horsepower. In that case, horsepower will be our output. Here, we are trying to predict the MPG. So MPG will be our output. So input will be the rest of the data, right? So we need to separate our inputs and the outputs. So for the that separation, we will say, we'll start with the training label data. Training data of MPG. So what I'm basically doing is I am separating one column from this training data set and assigning into a different variable called training label data. I can do the same for the testing. So if you look at our data set, this is what's going to happen. This is our original set of data. It had many separate rows and columns. So these are different samples. Sample number one, sample number two, like that, these are different cars. And in column wise, we had different values. The first one happens to be the MPG. But after that, you had other things like horsepower, year of manufacturing, number of cylinders, and things like that. In the first situation, we separated it as testing and training data. So that means part of this sample was selected for the training, and another part was selected for the testing. So this was for the training. That means, let's say 200 samples were selected for the training, and remaining 100 might have been selected for the testing. So that was the first separation. Then I separated again as inputs and outputs. So what happened here was I split it again like this. So in the training data set for testing, whatever the case, it will be the same. That means you can't have a different input for the training and a different variable input for a testing. They have to be the same. So once I had it, I split it again like this. So this is our prediction or the output. And this part will be our input for the neural network. Similarly, this part, the MPG part, will be our output for the neural network, the one we are trying to predict. And to predict it, we will give these values into the neural network, horsepower, year, and all these things. This will be the input. So in our neural network, let's say this is our neural network, we will input these horsepower, cylinders, and all these things as our input. and we will try to predict the MPEG. That is the thing that we are trying to predict. So the in the training phase, we will take this sample data, feed it in here, inputs and output, and calculate it. And in the testing phase, we will feed this part into here and see whether output is matching with there. So that's the idea. So that's why we need to split it. So visually, we split it into four different parts: training and testing, inputs and outputs. So training data splits into input output, testing again split into input output. Right. So with that, our pre-processing is finished. Now we are about to create the neural network. Finally, we are there. To create the neural network, we are going to use again the library, Keras library. How are we going to use it? We have several keywords for it. So let's give this neural network a name, neural net, assign Keras dot sequential. Sequential means it's a feedforward network. After that, you need to pass different parameters, right? Okay, you need to follow me carefully. Neural network, Keras.sequential. Sequential means it's a feedforward network. After that, you have to define layers. Okay, you have to define layers because neurons come with layers in a feedforward network. So for each layer, you have to give a separate statement. So the layers, if you remember, we have imported it from here, from tensorflow.keras import layers. We are going to use that to function to create layers. So I'm going to say layers dot dense, that's the layer type, and number of neurons. This layer can have 64 neurons. This layer can have 64 neurons. Then comes the activation function. Now, activation function is another name for the transfer function. So I'm going to say activation function. Right. Now we have learned about hard limit function. And I have also mentioned about things like log sigmoid. But this one will be a deep, kind of like a deep neural network. So we have so many neurons. So let's add a ReLU as our transfer function. Although this name might look very complicated, the actual graph of a ReLU function is quite simple. So if I quickly let me show you this one. It's actually two straight lines. Okay. So this is what the ReLU function looks like. Now, this is what the sigmoid looks like. It's like a S curve. But in a ReLU function, you basically have up to here 0 point, output is zero. So if your net value is zero or less, when you multiply the input by the weights and add them up, if that value happens to be zero or less, output will be zero. If it is larger than that, output will be equal to the net value. So if your net sum is, let's say, three, output will be three. So that's all there is for the ReLU function, right? This is what the function looks like. Compared to this, sigmoid and log sigmoids are more complicated. However, this one is more easily trainable. So let's go back there. So I'm basically converting my transfer function or the activation function. I'm telling this library that my transfer function or the activation function is actually a ReLU. Now for the first layer, I must tell how much inputs I have. So it knows how many weights to assign for this first layer. After that, it will automatically do it based on the previous layer's neuron it can calculate how many weights are there, because it's a fully connected kind of thing. Each layer is fully connected to the next layer. So if my previous layer have 5, next layer has 2, there will be 10 weights. But for the first layer, it doesn't know. So I must tell how many inputs will be there, right? So I can manually count how many attributes are there. Or to make it more flexible and expandable, I can do it in the code as well. So I'm basically going to say input shape. Rather than saying directly the fixed number, I can get it from the data. Len, if you remember, len means number of columns in a given data set, right? Len dot training data dot keys. Keys means different attributes. So this one basically gives you how much input you are going to get. Right, the parentheses are balanced. I guess it will be okay, right? So this is how you define a layer. Number of neurons, the activation of the transfer function. And for the first layer, you have to give this one. For the following layers, you don't have to do it. So let's add another layer. I'm going to create a 3-layer neural network. This is the second layer, layers. Dot dense. How much should I put there? 32 maybe? I don't know. We'll see. 32. Activation function again, the same one, ReLU. For this one, I don't need any size defined because it's already automatically calculated. By the way, I have to put a comma between the layers. I have to put a comma. 2 layers defined. The last one, the output. Now, how many output neurons should be there in the last layer for this example? Bhutika, what do you think? How many neurons should be there in the last layer of the neural network, output layer, for this given problem?
One.
Because number of neurons depend on how many things you are going to predict. If you are only predicting one thing, only one. If you are going to predict 2 different things, you need to have 2 different neurons. And if it's a categorical one where you have 1 or 10 coding, you might be trying to get 3 outputs. Then you need to have 3 neurons. This one, I am trying to predict only the MPG. So that means I need to have only 1. So for the last layer, I guess you can guess the code. Layers dot dense. After that, you have only 1. And it's a continuous value 1. So we can just say, okay, 1, whatever the default value. And if everything is okay, we should be able to run this one without any errors. So try it once and see if there are any missing parentheses or anything like that. If not, it should work. Okay, have you finished it? Tamai, ivarada karanavada. So this is the most important code in your neural network, because this is the one that actually create the neural network, right? Okay, let's compile the neural network. We have just created the architecture, the design, the number of layers, number of neurons, what their transfer function, and so forth. But there are other things that are needed when you are training the neural network, right? For example, how many, what are the maximum number of epochs you are going to have? What, how are you going to calculate the error, right? Something like that. So we'll do that one as well. So for this neural network, go for that variable, neural net dot compile. We use the word compile. Then there are several things that you have to do. It suggests an optimizer. Okay, we can try that if we have time. So ask me if I have time, how to put this optimizer. But for the one, for the time being, we'll go with the simplest thing. We'll first define the loss function. So what is a loss function? Can you remember last time when we are trying to train neural network from scratch, we wanted to calculate an error, right? So based on the error, we define how the weights were adjusted, right? So that's basically what the loss function means. How you want to measure the performance? How are you going to calculate the error, right? There are different ways to calculate the error. For example, RMS value, root mean square value, or the mean squared value, or the absolute error. Or if it's a categorization problem, you have the categorical errors. If it's a binomial kind of a binary category, you have another type of error, right? So depending on that, you can define how you are going to calculate the error. For this one, I'm going to go with the mean squared error, because this is a number, right? So the best way to get an error is the mean squared error, right? So I'm going to say mean squared error. That's the way it should calculate the error. Then we can also have some extra things like metrics. That means we can measure how the output is performing. Sorry, when the training is happening, what are the outputs we want to get for each epoch and things like that. For each epoch, I like to get the mean absolute error. And mean squared error. So when I'm training, I will get these two values for each epoch. What is the absolute error and what is the squared error, right? So absolute error will basically tell you, so they basically, the values gives you how the network is training. Let's see. Okay, everything's fine. Neural network is there. Let's start training. Training. Great. So how do you train it? To train it, you have a code called fit. So we can say neural net dot fit. This is how we are going to train it. We are going to use the function called fit. And of course, we have put this matrix in there. That means for each epoch, it's going to spit out this result. It's going to throw out these values. So we need a variable to catch those values as well. So that way we can see what's going to happen. So I'm just going to assign it as history. Now, don't get confused. I'm not assigning the neural network history. I'm just getting the result of this training function. So the result of this training function will be these, whatever the matrix. Now, if you are used to MATLAB, you will notice this is a difference. Because in the MATLAB, when you train the neural network, result will be a trained neural network. You will get a new network with trained weights. But here, we are always using this particular variable, training or testing or whatever happens. For this object, those things will happen. Right? So we are going to fit our data, train our neural network for our data. So I'm going to say X assign training data. And for Y, again, I'm going to do training label data. So X and Y are defined. So those are the inputs and outputs. And how much epochs? Good question. Epochs. Epochs 150. So that's the maximum number of epochs that is going to work. And there's another thing I haven't told you, validation split. What does that mean? After you have entered this code and run it, I'll explain what this validation split means. If your code is okay, you should be able to get something like this. You will be seeing the epoch and the training and the resulting metrics. That means the error and absolute error and everything. If everything is okay, this error should get smaller and smaller. It's smaller to a certain degree. Right. Were you able to come up to this point, and is your neural network working? Amila, what about you? Amila, Kanada? Christine, what about you? By the way, is your name Christine or Christina?
Christine, sir.
Christine, okay.
Sir, I did the coding, but I got error from the layers.dense, that part.
Okay, what is the error? Were you able to solve it?
That is saying that the layers.dense is not mentioned.
Right. Did you put this code and run it?
Wait.
At the top, you need to put it, and then also you need to run this cell.
Yes, I have done that one. Yes, sir.
But you still get something like that, okay? Can you share the screen? Are you from a laptop?
Yes, sir.
Others, how about others? Isha, have you finished?
Yes, sir.
Any errors?
No, sir.
It ran. Good, good, good. Now it's working.
Sir, I think it has stuck now. That's probably right.
Stuck. Okay.
It's not going.
Okay, okay, it's there. All right, right, okay, go there. Don't put that braces there. Try putting square brackets.
This one, sir.
Yeah, not the curly brackets. Put square brackets. Okay. Okay, layers dot. Now it's giving the first error. Right?
Now it's working.
Okay. If you get an error, you can't continue, okay?
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Sure, sure. Right. Now let's go back to here. So there are two things I want to mention. One is this validation set. So what is this validation? Now in actual neural network training, time to time, it will check whether it had trained properly, or is there an overfitting, or if it had reached its particular goal and things like that. Now for that, again, you can't use the training set. Because in that case, again, your accuracy and the whether the network is properly training cannot be measured using the same set of training data. So in reality, you have a validation data set as well. So validation means while the training is happening, time to time, it will use this validation set to check the performance of the neural network. So that validation set is not used for training, not used for actually adjusting. It's just used for validating the results. So if you want something like that, you need to have this validation data set. So that's what I mean by validation split 0.2. So 20% of our training data set actually went into validation. So that's something you can do. So at the moment, you can actually train it, no issue. But it seems to be training not that well. So one thing I like to do is to add an optimizer. So optimizer basically improve the performance. So that's what the word optimizing means, right? So I'm going to say optimizer. Actually, you can even include it using a comma here if you want. Errors. Dot optimizers. RMS prompt. Then you can give some values. So this one will basically remove any oscillations with it. So it's a, kind of like having a momentum into this one. And after this, somewhere here, whatever the place you like, you can say optimizer is equal to let's have a different names for this. My optimizer, otherwise it might be confusing for you all. Optimizer is assign my optimizer. Right? So I basically create an optimizing for this neural network and then I'm going to train it. Hopefully it will be a little bit better. Seem to be the same result. Anyway, now you know at least how to put an optimizer. So I put 150 puts, it's finished there. So training is done. So that's how the neural network training part is complete doing. Only two cells to go before we finish it. So we want to test the data. So we have created a neural network. Trained it. Now we want to test it. So to test it, we need our neural network to predict some values. How can we do it? We can say neural net predict. After that, we can give our testing data. And the result, we will assign it to some other variable. let's call it testing prediction. Right, so our result is there, but it's better if we can have it in a graph. So we can get a good idea of how much correlation we have it, right? Unfortunately, we don't have any libraries at the moment that can draw a good graph. So I need to import another library. Okay. So let's import Matplotlib. Seaborn. Let's import this one. Import matplotlib. Apply plot as PLTO. Good. So I just added a new line here. I'm going to use this to create a plot. Matplotlib.pyplot as PLT. Okay. Right. Hope you have done it. So I'm going to plot an scatter plot. Plot scatter. By the way, once you put it there, you need to run it. Otherwise, it won't import. So let's try it. PLT dot scatter testing label data versus testing label data means the original values created by the original values in the data set. And testing prediction data means testing data prediction means the ones that are predicted by the neural network. So let's see. Okay. So you can see there's a pretty good correlation between these values. So that means the, let's add some labels, otherwise it can be a little confusing. PLT.xlabel. So x-axis will be the values in the data set. Let's call it actual value, actual MPG. And y-axis will be the predicted MPG. Now we have the labels as well. What happened there? Okay, spelling mistake. Right. So you can see the actual and the predicted ones are very close. When it is zero, it's almost predicting zero. When it is close to two, it's almost predicting close to two. Okay. Were you able to come to this point, everyone? Were you able to get this graph?
Sir, can you show the how to plot the matplotlib plot?
Okay, I'll just put it there. Okay, so this is the one that library I imported. So why are we getting minus values for MPG? Any idea? Can MPG be minus? Why are we getting M minus values? Lakshmi, what do you think? Why are we getting minus values? Can you get a minus value for MPG?
No, sir.
We can't, but we are getting minus values. Why? Any idea?
They may be wrong.
Not exactly. Anyone else having any idea why we are getting minus values?
So these are standardized.
Exactly. Can you remember somewhere at the top, we standardized them. We converted them to Z values. So our neural network only saw the standardized values. So it's only predicting the values based on those things. So if you want to get the actual MPG, we have to reverse the formula, right? We already have the mean and the standard deviation. We have to multiply by that one and add that mean and get the value, right? So the predictions are not incorrect. They are correct. That's why we are saying this straight line. That's why for the, even for the actual MPG, we are getting minus values. Actual MPG means the values we taken from the data set, not predicted the real cars. That's why you have minus values for actual ones as well, because we change the data set to suit our neural network. So if you want to give it to someone else to use, we have to convert them back into the original format, right? That's another step. I'm not going to cover it here, but you have to know at the end of this, you have to convert it back to the original MPG by using that mean and the standard deviation, right? So that's why you are getting minus values. So with that, we come to the conclusion of today's lecture, and this will be the last lecture about artificial neural networks. There are so many things you can do with artificial neural networks, but most of them are not directly related to financial mathematics. So that's why I went to this regression and that kind of thing. But if you search a new YouTube or Google something, you will find a lot of things. There are neural networks that are able to play games, video games, and that can create poems, draw images, do style transfers. So many things you can do with neural networks. But with about 3 days limit, we have to focus it up to this particular point. So that's why we have only focused on to this one. So hopefully you have got an idea. So at the end, you need to be able to know what a neural network is, why we need neural networks, different types of neural networks, structure of a neuron and a neural network, how the values are calculated inside the neural network, how to train the neural network, what is a training algorithm, and what are the steps in this delta rule and things like that, and the termination criteria, when to use the neural networks, what are the practical applications of neural networks, and how to apply it using TensorFlow. You might need to know how to import the data, how to pre-process the data, and remove any unwanted values like not available values, comments, and things like that, how to normalize them, how to create a neural network using the TensorFlow, train it, test it, and also when it comes to data, how to separate the input, output, training data set, testing data set, and finally to measure the performance of the neural network and those things, right? So we had covered all of these things. So if you have any questions regarding neural networks, this should be the time to ask. I think I have taken about 5 extra minutes. Anything you want to ask?
Just want to ask about an error which is coming.
Okay. Do you want to share it?
Yes, I'll share. Can you see the screen, sir?
Yes, it says value error. Can you go a little bit below to the end? No, no, I mean the error. I want to see the rest of the error. Unknown loss function means, okay, where's this Q? Did you get the error? Okay, if you correct it, can you run it again? Because I think it says there's a spelling mistake about mean squared error or something. Okay, now can you run the last second one as well? Now it's working, eh? Or does the error comes after the training is finished? But it trained. You had a small spelling mistake. So you have to be careful. And when you get an error, usually at the end, you have a statement which gives you a better idea of what the error is. Okay. Right. Then shall we wind up for today?
Excuse me, sir. Yeah, can we find the recording of the lecture?
It's in the that YouTube playlist. I'm not sure whether I had uploaded the previous. Are you referring to the previous week's one? Or
yes, the previous week. And actually, Hiruni wants this week once he asks.
Yeah. I usually upload every lecture into that. In your course, at the very top, there's a link saying the recorded video lectures or something. Yes, just after the announcement, there's a link saying link to the recorded lectures. So it will link to the YouTube playlist. So whenever I upload the recorded one, that will be the place to check. If it is not there, that means I have somehow forgotten to upload it. Then you can just send me an email. I will upload it. But sometimes I forget it because it takes some time to encode this Zoom lecture. So by the time it is finished, it's closed and I forget to upload it. So that, but the place will be the same. Under that playlist, you should see, I think, three videos at the moment.
Okay, sir. We'll check it.
Okay, right? At the moment, I don't know. I have to check, but I think there should be about 3 or 4 videos under that particular playlist. Okay, if there are no more questions, I will wind up for today. Then have a nice weekend. Okay, goodbye.
Thank you, sir.